are you real concerned about this global warming?
I'm only concerned about the incredible frenzy and hype for something that's a total myth. That concerns me a lot, because people are going hysterical about it. It's amazing to me how upset so many people are, and how many billions of dollars apparently our governments are going to spend of our tax dollars to combat something that isn't real. That has my attention, believe me. As a scientist, I know that global warming doesn't really exist at all in any sense of significance, and that we have nothing to worry about.
Now, are you saying that there hasn't even been any warming?
There's absolutely natural climate fluctuations. We have little ice ages. We have warm-ups. Historically, the Earth has vacillated through all of these. Solar cycles change dramatically. Ocean currents change. And all of that has a significant impact on climate. And the building of cities, the flying of airplanes, the existence of all these billions of people on Earth have all influenced the climate of Earth. But none of it is of significance. And thank goodness, things are doing just fine.
So you're not in a panic over the icebergs melting and the sea levels rising? And
I promise you, 20 years from today, I'll be the one that's laughing. The icebergs, the ice caps at the poles are not going to melt. The oceans are not going to flood the coast. People are not going to die. We're not going to have global climate change that cuts off the food supply. We're not going to have thousands of species eliminated as they lose their habitat. None of these things is going to happen. The Earth is going to, the climate's going to change with cycles of the sun and with ocean currents, and we're all going to do just fine.
But Al Gore has a very convincing video out there that seems to show that we're really facing a catastrophe.
I'm very well aware of the hype. The media is full of it every day. Al Gore got the Nobel Peace Prize, an Oscar, and a Grammy, and apparently millions of dollars. Al Gore, I believe, is sincere in his belief, but oh, so misguided, as is the entire UN IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change.
Well, doesn't that bring us to the point that Mr. Gore makes and many others, that science has spoken? There is a universal consensus among scientists.
Well, if you look at the history of the IPCC, it was formed by people whose agendas were of question. They really wanted to get back at the industrialized nations and get them to pay penance to the third world nations for their pollution of the atmosphere through their industrial activities. It was the little guys picking on the big guys kind of concept, which is very common in the UN. And it was from people who had a world government in mind. That history is pretty well documented by an engineer named Alan Cheatham. He has really dug into it. And there's that panel was, so you create this bureau within the UN on climate change. Well, its mission and its existence then is to prove that there's climate change. So it starts hiring scientists and giving them research money to go out and prove that its mission is valid, to prove its point. And all of this, and then it holds meetings and it does publicity, and the whole thing just crescendos and builds. Now, was there a consensus of 2,500 scientists at the Bali meeting? Heavens no. The key paragraphs or chapters of this report and the research documents behind it, which are very impressive, not anything that were widely read by these scientists. They were, many of them were political scientists, as it were scientists who have a political mission. Representatives there from Greenpeace and the Sierra Club and from government ministries, in addition to some well-meaning scientists. But it appears that only about 25 scientists out of that 2,500 actually read and reviewed in a scientific manner, a peer review, the key chapter on radiative forcing by carbon dioxide causing climate change. So there was no huge consensus built up at the IPCC. And there's almost more scientific consensus on the other side, where 19,000 scientists signed a petition against the Kyoto Protocol, where 400 plus scientists spoke out as skeptics on global warming in 2007, where at least four dozen TV meteorologists have spoken out against global warming. There's no consensus, and to try to shut off the debate is a political strategy. One of the great things about science is the debate that takes place, and the debate should never be shut off.
It's my understanding that at Bali, in November of 2007, at the conference there, that quite a number of scientists who went there in order to engage in debate there were not allowed to have any kind of forum there.
There were 100 scientists who wrote a letter of complaint at the meeting. That was one group that spoke up. And we have documentation and statements and papers by any number of scientists who were on the IPCC panel, who were reviewers and had been with it for years, who shared in that Nobel Peace Prize, because the panel shared the prize with Al Gore, who shared in that prize, who say that this panel should be disbanded, it's a sham.
Because a lot of the scientists who participated in the panel actually providing scientific input,
it was ignored.
Then later their scientific work was basically shoved aside for political.
They asked questions, they made comments, and essentially it was pushed aside, ignored. And that is not the scientific process, obviously.
Now, you were involved in the middle of your career in broadcasting 20, 30 years ago when we were told in similar panic terms that we were going to face global cooling and ice age.
I was a TV weathercaster in Chicago when the head of the Department of Meteorology at the University of Wisconsin announced the coming of an ice age. And Time magazine came out with a picture of the skyscrapers of Chicago trapped in a huge glacier that was creeping down over the Midwest. And clearly, as a television meteorologist, I was called upon, I was working for ABC at the time, I was called upon to report on this and to investigate it and to interview people and to, so yeah, I was there.
You're still waiting for the ice cap.
I never believed it was coming, nor do I believe global warming is coming. And in fact, are you aware, and I'm sure some people seeing this are aware, that officials of both the Canadian and Russian government in the past 6 weeks have warned of a coming ice age.
It's my understanding, and this other scientists have well been looking at this, pointing out the connection between our weather and the solar activity.
Yeah, this has to do with what's known as a moder minimum, where the sun goes into hibernation, as they describe it, where the number of solar flares diminishes to zero and the sun lays quiet. And clearly, the sun is the source of all energy on Earth. Nothing happens here without the sun. Without the sun, it's all over. And so how bright the sun shines is a key element. And you and I were taught in school of the solar constant, a figure that represented the energy arriving at Earth from the sun, as though it were a consistent light bulb burning. Well, it's not that at all, of course. It's a great ball of hydrogen exploding in atomic fusion, and it is this great mass of fire has a lifetime to it, and it has ups and downs. It is not uniform, and it burns irregularly, and it throws off huge amounts of radioactive materials at times, and at other times it lays quieter. And which side of the sun is facing toward Earth at the time of these events has a lot to do with the energy received at Earth. And so all of this is the controlling factor of the climate on Earth. And if you plot the temperatures of Earth, the ice ages and the warm spells, the medieval warm period and so on, and you plot those all out as best we can reproduce them, but we didn't have thermometers for so long. Now we only had thermometers for a couple hundred years, and they're not very accurate. And where you put the thermometer is pretty important, too. But let's say you do the best you can from tree rings or whatever other samples you get from ice cores or whatever, and you try to get the long-term temperatures of Earth. And then you compare that to your best record of solar cycles, they seem to lie together. So as goes the sun, so goes the Earth. I think that's pretty clear. It's daddy.
And there are many scientists who view the very minor increase in temperature we have had experienced in more recent times, not with alarm, but suggest that that is a benefit.
Well, there is a, if you live in Canada or Minnesota, you might feel that a little global warming would be a wonderful thing. And I think you have a strong point. What is the right temperature for planet Earth? What is our ideal climate regime? Is it what we have had for the last 50 years? Or is it something warmer or colder than that? I would tend to think a few degrees warmer might be a very good thing. And you indicate that indeed we have had a warming. I guess the preponderance of evidence might lead to best suggest that we might have had a degree 0.2 of warming over the last 30 years or 40 years. But that's, boy, that's vague, and it's hard to pin down. Because during this period of time, these great cities have built up. And urban heat islands are very real. So if you have a thermometer in the city, its temperature has definitely climbed. But the thermometers in the countryside around that city haven't increased, and significantly, if at all. And so it depends which thermometers you're reading. And you also, we've even discovered that they used to whitewash the little shelters, the little white boxes with the louvers on the side that had the weather thermometers in them. And then they started painting them with latex paint. It's about a degree difference between whitewash and latex. Thank you. I mean, this isn't easy stuff now.
So there's a lot of variables here.
Absolutely.
Even if we have, say, we have granted a 1 degree increase, and even that is not certain, or somewhere in that neighborhood, how does that compare with other periods in history? That we've had larger increases, have we not?
Oh, of course. Around 1900, the Northwest Passage was clear of ice. We had a warm spell. We had the Little Ice Age, you know, that preceded that by about 300 years. Remember that Greenland was settled by the Nordsmen when the coast of Greenland were fertile and clear and beautiful farming country, and they established farms that operated there for more than 100 years. Those same coasts that are now covered in ice, and where the ice is reportedly melting now, and the alarmists are screaming about it as though it's some catastrophe. There's these ups and downs.
In previous warming periods, we don't have any great evidence of species extinction or what?
Well, take the polar bear, for instance. There's so much talk about the polar bear today. Excuse me? Polar bear made it through all of that. The polar bears have existed through all this time, despite the fact the Eskimos are hunting them for food and clothing. They are the lifeblood of the Eskimo nation. They need the meat, they need the fur, they need the hides. Polar bears are part of their existence, they're the food cycle. And despite the changes in climate, despite the Eskimos, the polar bears have lasted through all of this time. And now there's this incredible alarm about the polar bears because Al Gore stood in front of a picture of a polar bear on a piece of ice floating in the ocean and decried the death of the polar bear. Well, the polar bear, that picture was phony to start with. It was taken by a scientist on a research vessel that was up examining ice, and the polar bears were over on the mainland. They were very curious about that boat and those people. They'd never seen anything like that in their lives, so they jumped on this ice floe and floated out to see it. Maybe they thought they were going to eat the scientist off the boat. I don't know. But then when they were through having their look-see, they jumped in the water and swam back to the shore. Now, no polar bears died in that, and I think it is horrible fraud to take that picture, which was taken from that scientist without permission, and to turn that into an emotional plea to people who love polar bears. That is so unfair. And those polar bears are, the people who really keep track say there are more polar bears living on Earth today than there have been in recent years, about 25,000.
What about the concerns that many people have about increased tsunamis and hurricanes as a result of...
Well, it's ridiculous. Excuse me? How about the hurricane of 1900 that wiped out Galveston? Man didn't cause that. How about the historic hurricanes that have hit the Florida Keys? 1969, I was in Hurricane Camille, the most powerful hurricane ever to hit the United States. Was that part of global warming? And back in 69, we hadn't even talked about the coming ice age yet then. And to blame Katrina on global warming is another one of these emotional frauds. It offends me. Katrina was when it made landfall, was a Category 3 hurricane. And it happened to produce a very heavy rainfall over a city built below sea level, protected by inferior dikes, because while science makes the world great, government screws it up. And the government hadn't built decent dikes and taken care of its business. You know, our whole society, government takes so much credit, gets so much in the spotlight. News seems to be all about government. And for them to decry Katrina caused what happened in New Orleans to happen was ridiculous. It's because the politicians hadn't built the dikes properly, the pumps and the dike system.
Does it concern you the increasing political impact of government on science, particularly in this field where we see many scientists worried about taking a public stand on this because they're afraid that government entities might cut off their grant support?
Well, I'm sure that's all true. I don't have the documentation to say it, so you have to say it, I can't. I have not had a scientist say to me, I'm afraid. I've had some TV weathermen say to me, I'm afraid. I can't say anything because of my job. But I haven't actually had a scientist say to me yet, I fear for my job, or I have to take this position I don't believe in. And if they do, for shame on them. I would rather be right and called names and abused than give lip service to a fraud. But we don't. All four of the remaining, as of the date we're recording this, political candidates for president of the United States are global warming advocates. Almost everybody in the U.S. Congress and Senate. There are some notable exceptions. The president is weak, but certainly doesn't speak out against global warming. The governor of California is on the bandstand. The mayor of New York has just declared the threat of global warming worse than the threat of terrorism. All of this incredible grandstanding by politicians, they read the polls. 80% of the Americans believe global warming is a threat. Why do they believe that? Because of the incredible hype on television. Why is the incredible hype on television? Because of the UN telling them there's a consensus of 2,500 scientists, and because Al Gore stands up to speak, and he's well-produced, and he's strong and loved by the media. Voila, global warming catastrophe. The sky is falling. I'm so sick of it, I could die.
Now, you were founder of the Weather Channel, and now the Weather Channel has become a leading propaganda font for global warming.
Today, the Weather Channel is for sale, and I have a finger crossed and a strong hope that the new owner of the Weather Channel will stop that one-sided nonsense.
You mentioned it, other weather men on television networks saying they have to keep silent or toe the mark on this.
Yeah, they have families to feed, mortgages to pay. They're real guys.
This is fairly prevalent in the major media because most of the media have taken a stand in
yes, absolutely. I'm in my retirement job. If I get fired here today, I'm fine, thank you. My retirement is well taken care of. I only work because it's fun. Beats staying home. And the money's nice, but I get by fine without it. But I happen to work for a company that has been very supportive of me. There aren't many like that. This is one of the few TV stations in the United States that's owned by an individual where I work, KUSI. And they have my global warming briefs posted on their website. They allow me to use their studio as I am here to do interviews. Yesterday I was on the Glenn Beck Show on CNN. Today I talked to you. Tomorrow it's somebody else. Next month they'll give me days off to go to New York to be at a conference on the 1st of March. All of these things I'm supported by, and very few TV weathercasters have that.
You mentioned the United Nations and government following things up. It seems if we were to go forward with Kyoto or any variation of Kyoto, which would impose vast restrictions on all human activity, that government and global governance through the United Nations would be the big beneficiaries.
Well, all of this is predicated on carbon being a dirty word. All right. And the carbon we're talking about is carbon dioxide. And it's the last remaining cornerstone of global warming. The hockey stick chart, ridiculous scientific fraud, got shot down. It was in Al Gore's book and movie. The pronouncements by NASA about global temperature averages going up have been corrected, and now we know the warmest U.S. decade was the 30s, not the 90s. That silliness is in it. All that's left now is carbon. And now we got the whole carbon credits thing and this incredible financial thing going on. And government is all wrapped up in it. And it is all predicated on carbon dioxide being the forcing agent for global warming. Now, I'm sitting in the atmosphere. And let's say within this box my hands are defining, let's say, a 9 inches square. Let's say there are 100,000 molecules of atmosphere. 38 of those are carbon dioxide. Even after all the fossil fuel we've burned, only 38. When you and I breathe, our breath out is carbon dioxide. It's a natural component. It's not a pollutant. It's a natural component of the atmosphere. When plants turn green and flourish, their whole process is fueled by carbon dioxide. That's what our crops and our forests are thriving because of increased carbon dioxide. Ah, but when fossil fuels burn to power cars or power plants, they emit, as in their exhaust emission, carbon dioxide, and that's what this is all about. The environmentalists have taken over the global warming frenzy because they want to get rid of fossil fuel. And so they are making this whole carbon is the enemy of mankind thing to try to get rid of fossil fuels. Well, fossil fuels have powered our civilization. They are what makes the world go. I think they're 20th century stuff, and that's when they came and powered this incredible revolution. But now it's over. And so we got to phase them out. We got to come up with something new, but we don't have it yet. And they built this whole fictitious case that this carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, which has doubled over the last 50 years because of these emissions, that is driving global warming because it forces the atmosphere. It's like it's a magic component in the atmosphere. It forces the water vapor, which is the primary greenhouse gas, to be more 2.5 times more powerful in heating the earth. And they built up this whole case. I've got a scientific paper that's the UN paper on radiative forcing by carbon dioxide that's 240 pages long. They've really worked at trying to build their case. Their case is no good at all. Doesn't hold up under peer review, doesn't hold up under study. And any number of scientists, including Arthur and Noah Robinson, have done a fabulous job of showing how this whole CO2 forcing issue is phony as it can be. And without that, the global warming advocates don't have anything left. Their whole case is destroyed scientifically. But they still have the media. They still have the government.
But we can end all of the carbon-based fuels and just rely on solar and wind power.
Well, no. It'd be so lovely if we could come up with a great alternate fuel. I remember we were talking about the 70s when I was covering the Ice Age. I was also covering the development of hydrogen fuel for automobiles. Great concept. Couldn't make it work. We have some hydrogen-powered buses today and a few government vehicles, but there's some inert problems or innate problems with it that haven't been solved. We look at fuel cells. We haven't come up with the solutions yet. Our hybrid automobiles are a wonderful step, but they are not practical yet. Economically very unpractical still. And solar power might work great in San Diego, where I live, but it doesn't work with a hoot in Antarctica or Alaska, and it's not very good in Seattle. And wind power is only good at a few limited places. It's a very expensive technology still. We don't have, and solar power, we're getting better and better at it all the time. Better and better and better, and it could be that it will be an ultimate solution, but we're a long way from being there.
It seems the one solution that we do have for a big part of the picture, right up the road from you, 50 miles from San Diego to San Onofre, nuclear power. But the folks that are opposed to all the carbon-based fuels have been fighting nuclear power for 30 years, too.
I also covered the first nuclear power plants opening as a young newsman. That was a big event, and we were told power would be generated so cheaply we wouldn't even have meters anymore. It'd be send $5 a month and use all the electric power you want, was kind of the concept. I'm serious. I mean, this is the 1950s, and we were told this was going to be the savior of Earth. And in some ways, it could have been. Nuclear power is pretty amazing. But environmentally, politically, very difficult sell. I have no reason to, I would not challenge the building of a nuclear power plant near your house. Don't build one by my house.
We see France and many other countries going ahead with it, but here in the United States where we pioneered it, not a nuclear power plant in the last...
It's an outrage, of course. And this country is... Has this country gone nuts? We have emotional opposition to so many things that, on a practical basis, make wonderful sense. And that's the way it is with nuclear power. Three Mile Island, you know, got this incredible media play. Chernobyl was indeed a true tragedy. And that's about... It's kind of almost the beginning and end for nuclear power. If it ever makes a comeback in my lifetime, I'll be amazed. But it is a magnificent power source.
Since 2000 or 2001, correct me, we haven't seen any raise in the temperature that the global warming folks have been advocating.
We're in a cooling trend. The Earth has gone, the sun has gone quiet. Those guys in Canada and Russia are talking about an ice age, though they've probably gone over the edge. They've got a point. The sun's in a very quiet phase, and a cooling trend is underway. And I'm sure the global warming alarmists are going nuts, because, Jim Hansen, who runs the NASA temperature program, still has his ways of massaging the data so that it accurately portrays in his mind the Earth is warm. The truth is, you know, South America had the worst winter in 50 years. China's had the worst winter now in 50 years. The U.S. is having a real old-fashioned winter. The Alaska just finished one of the worst cold spells in a couple of decades. I didn't see any press on it at all, but 40 below for 7 days straight at Fairbanks. A place called Chicken went to 72 below. Some of the coldest weather they've ever seen in modern times in Alaska. The Arctic ice cap, we heard all about it melting last summer. That sucker's frozen up. Oh, man, is the North Pole frozen up now. It's been a dastardly cold winter there.
People are praying for global warming.
And I'm wondering what the global warming doomsayers are going to use next year to point to claim that global warming is happening.
Well, it brings you to the final point here. Are you hopeful that with yourself and many other of the scientists finally being able to speak out in an organized fashion, and with at the same time the temperatures cooperating, and it's becoming very obvious that we are not facing a real imminent threat, that there may be some sanity returning and we may be able to head this off before a Kyoto-style political solution is put in place?
I'll give you a flip answer. No, I am not hopeful. In this crazy world, I see things we shouldn't expect, that the UN will tell us it's over, that they were wrong, that Al Gore will tell us he's wrong and return his prizes, suddenly politicians will step up and tell us the truth. No, these things aren't going to happen. Things we can hope for, that through your efforts, mine, and those of thousands of other people who know the truth, that we can begin to change some public opinion and calm the fears, and maybe enough that our governments won't spend billions and billions of dollars on silliness. Maybe. We can hope for that.
Thanks for watching The Auto Channel. For more great automotive information and entertainment, visit theautochannel.com, the Internet's most complete and comprehensive automotive information resource.